The train rocked along through the night, and I watched the darkness flutter by with stray farm lights and the occasional small Missouri town. The old porter in his white coat, his hat cocked just a little to one side, shuffled by now and then. My dad, who was at work three cars forward of me and had asked the porter to keep an eye on me. It was my first time on a train. I was 13, alone in the passenger car, and headed for Kansas City. The next day, August 26, 1961, the New York Yankees were playing the Kansas City A's, and my dad and I had seats in the left field bleachers. Roger Maris and Mickey Mantle were battling each other to break Babe Ruth's home run record that year. And on that day, Maris, who went on to break the Babe's record, would hit his 51st home run of the season. And Yogi Berra would play left field within shouting distance of my dad and me. As that train rolled along through the darkness, I thought, as the saying goes, I had died and gone to heaven. In truth, my father was something of a phantom to me, and that trip to Kansas City was the only thing I can remember we did together, just the two of us. Growing up, I would go to sleep on any particular night, and when I woke up the next morning, he would be gone. Several days of relaxed parenting later, I would go to sleep at night, wake up the next morning, and there he would be in his bed. On those days, my mother kept a tight rein on household noise until, like a bear coming out of hibernation, Dad growled down the hallway to sit at the kitchen table where Mom would put a strong cup of coffee in front of him. Occasionally, I woke up on those days to find a peace offering at the foot of my bed. A book, a football, a baseball glove, and once, only once, a can of fried grasshoppers. Now, in the late 1950s, fried grasshoppers were exotic anywhere, but in Siloam Springs, Arkansas, a town of 3,000 Christian souls, they were a miracle. I refused to let my mom open the can. For years, it occupied a prominent place in my bedroom, and I showed it to all friends and visitors. It was, hands down, the most popular show-and-tell item of Mrs. Draper's third-grade class in the year 1957. From the 1880s through the middle of the 20th century, most of the mail in the United States was moved by train on the railway post office, one or more train cars dedicated as mobile post offices and dubbed the RPO. The men who worked the mail in the RPOs were an elite group, the most highly trained members of the U.S. Postal Service. They were expected to sort 600 pieces of mail per hour. The entrance exam required a 97% for a passing grade, and the clerks were retested regularly. As the trains rolled across country night and day, they dropped off and picked up sacks of mail to and from the little towns along the way and sorted the mail as they went. My dad was a foreman on the Kansas City to Texarkana run. For security reasons, he and all his crew carried snub-nosed 38s. They smoked unfiltered Camels or Lucky Strikes, a few smoked pipes. My dad smoked both. They developed a swagger and a powerful camaraderie in their own jargon. Mail from New York was from the madhouse. An unsortable or misaddressed letter was a Nixie. And a damaged or empty mail sack was a bum. And when the train left the station, someone yelled, "Throw the bums out." I found it impossible to sleep on the train. Slow hours passed until about 3 a.m. my father appeared in the door of the passenger car and motioned me to follow him. When we entered the RPO, the mail clerks were busy sorting the mail and bagging it up for drop-off. I couldn't help regretting just a little that their snub-nosed 38s were not strapped to their thighs. The pistols were lying in their holsters on the work tables or on top of the sorting racks. None of these men had ever had cause to use them. My father timed my visit to the RPO so that I could see the most thrilling part of the job. the snatch and toss of bags of mail at one of the many small towns along the way. Each small town had a trackside crane arm positioned as close to the tracks as possible so that the release arm would be only a few inches from the passing train. The agent at the local train depot hung a leather and canvas bag containing outgoing mail from the local post office on the arm. The RPO car, on the other hand, had a metal V-shaped train catcher arm attached at the doorway and extended by a mail clerk at just the right moment to snag the mailbag while not snagging any switch targets, wires, or semaphores. Simultaneously, the mail clerk tossed a bag of incoming mail off the train onto the platform. If the clerk's timing was not precise, he would miss the catch. And if he did not launch his own mail bag far enough onto the platform, it would be sucked under the train, resulting in what the clerks called a snowstorm. I stood to one side of the car and watched as my dad picked up a bag of mail and walked over to the open door of the train car. He leaned against the door frame, watching, the mail bag in one hand and his other hand holding the lever of the train catcher arm. Then, with a movement as smooth as a bowler, he lowered the catcher arm and tossed his bag of mail into the night. A half second later, a loud thump startled me, and my dad lowered the lever and pulled a bag of mail onto the train. He had not even taken his pipe out of his mouth, as if he were retrieving a can of beer from the fridge. And the rest of the crew continued working, their conversation casual. I was awestruck. 8 years after that night, I was at the Naval Hospital in San Diego training to be a hospital corpsman. I received a piece of mail that contained only a small envelope on which a 6-cent Franklin Roosevelt stamp was canceled with the citation, KC in Tex, Train 16, January 12, 1968, RPO. And the words, last run, RPO, were stamped where the address belonged. Trucks and airplanes had finally made the RPO obsolete. It was the end of an era. My dad felt compelled to mark the event with a simple message. The demise of the way of life that defined him needed notice, and I was the one that needed to notice. I thought of that trip to Kansas City, heard the clacking of the rails, felt the rocking of the train car, and smelled the leather, wood, canvas, and paper. The punch of the catcher arm grabbing a bag of mail from the crane, the sweet smell of tobacco and of coffee poured from the thermoses. And my father, in the middle of it all, casually emptying the bag of mail he had just retrieved from the darkness as the men around him continued sorting. I was an outsider that night on the train, looking on a world as mysterious to me at 13 as the Playboy magazines I kept hidden under my mattress. The adult world, playing out in front of me like a Humphrey Bogart movie, and me soaking it in. But my father's notice, last run, RPO, laid bare a world of impermanence, of loss, where the things we love and sometimes love itself cannot last. I was 29 years old and newly married when 50 years of smoking those unfiltered cigarettes came calling on my father, and after a year of chemo and the loss of his wavy black hair in which he took great pride, he went peacefully in the night and, as my aunt, his sister, would say, walked hand in hand with Jesus into glory everlasting. And now, at the age my father was when he died, with sons of my own who are adults in this adult world, there are times when I think longingly of that train ride, with the visit to the RPO just ahead of me around the bend, and Roger Maris's 51st home run just a few hours away. With all the mystery, joy, pain, and craziness of life waiting, unknown, out there in front of me. And I wonder, whatever happened to that can of fried grasshoppers?